to the live streaming if they like. What's that? Yeah, you can come up here and wave if you want. Hello. All right, so thank you very much for that song service. Let's turn our Bibles. Let's go to Galatians chapter 6. And as you know, we've been studying this book for some time now. I believe this is, what, our 29th point or hour that we've been teaching this book. We're getting close to finish. We should be finishing up this coming week, but every time I say something like that, the Holy Spirit leads me to something else, so I can't promise you anything. But in any case, we should be done with this soon. Then we're going to go back into Proverbs and knock off a couple of those chapters again. And then come back, and I think the next thing is going to be the book of Ephesians. So I think we're going to do that next, and maybe we're just going to kind of keep going back and forth between Proverbs and these New Testament books and try to knock off, especially the smaller New Testament books like Ephesians and Colossians and those things and Philippians. So we'll go through those and so that we can get through our Bibles and understand what the mystery doctrines are for the church age. So in any case, we find ourselves now in Galatians chapter 6. And in Galatians chapter 6, we find ourselves with two object lessons in regard to agape love. Remember, in chapter 5, we had the seven characteristics of what it means to have Christ formed in you. And that last characteristic was agape love. Again, love your neighbor as you love yourself. And to have love within your soul, you need to be filled by the Holy Spirit. As a result of having the filling of the Holy Spirit and operating in the love of Christ, you have the 9 divine good production fruits or manifestations of the fruit of the Spirit in chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. So we had that last great message in regard to what agape love is and divine good production. And then when we get into chapter 6, we really have two object lessons in regard to what agape love is all about. And first and foremost, in verses 1 through 5, we see it's in regard to personal relationships and especially how we should be treating the downtrodden man or the one that is has entered into reversionism or the person that's having problems and difficulties in their lives. How do we treat them and how do we deal with them is what we've been noting in verses 1 through 5 this past week. And then in verses 6 through 10, we also understand the use of our money. In other words, how we give of ourselves. And it's a little bit more than just money, as we're going to see here, but ultimately it's our time, our talent, or our treasure, but it does relate to our giving, especially in regard to our pastor teacher and supporting him. So in verses 1 through 5, we've noted that in some detail this past week, and we understand what it means to be the Spirit-led believer and apply agape love. And ultimately, it is in regard to how we think about one another, how we serve one another, how we treat one another. And as we have here in verses 1 through 5, especially those who are in reversionism and enter back into Satan's cosmic system, whether that be through moral degeneracy or immoral degeneracy, which was legalism or immorality, as we would call it. So let's look at verses 1 through 5 again, where it says in verse 1, "Brethren, even if a man is caught in any trespass," again, you've witnessed him sinning, you understand and recognize this is a reality, this isn't a rumor, you didn't make it up, or it's not gossip that's come down the pipeline, this is a reality, he's been caught in a sin. And that word for trespass, remember what we talked about this past week, is an interesting word because it means a misstep. In other words, walking outside of God's will and plan for your life, getting off the path of righteousness and getting involved in human good, sin, or evil. Then it goes on to say, "You who are spiritual," again, the spiritually mature believer who is led by the Spirit, filled with God the Holy Spirit, ultimately they are to what? Restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. That word for gentleness is what we also saw in the fruits of the Spirit in verses 22 through 23, and specifically in verse 23, the gentleness aspect. But it talks about humility and grace orientation. Again, you recognize that you're a sinner, therefore you recognize the grace of God that has come into your life, and you share that grace now with other people. You give them grace, you cut them slack, and you help them to overcome their sins rather than condemning them and tearing them down for their sins. So restore such a one. We're going to talk about that in just a minute. But each one looking to yourself, lest you too be tempted. Ultimately, if you are cutting somebody else down or ripping them apart because of their sins, guess what? You too are now entering into sin because you don't have a heart of forgiveness. You don't have a heart of grace. And even though you might not have committed the egregious sin that they committed, just because you are treating them with contempt in your soul and treating them with evilness within your soul, ultimately you have entered into sin as well. Then in verse 22, bear one another's burdens and thus fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one examine his own work, and then he will have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone and not in regard to another. For each one shall bear his own load. So ultimately up on the board here, we have this category of personal relationships where we can apply agape love, that impersonal and unconditional love for our fellow mankind. And we do that in five ways. You see, each of these verses give us an understanding of how we apply agape love. First and foremost, that word restore there, remember I gave that to you this past week, and ultimately it is used as a medical term in the old Greek language, and ultimately it meant to mend a broken leg or a broken bone. So again, it was also used for mending a torn net or a ripped net. So they would mend the net or they would mend the broken bone. Ultimately, this word restore here means to mend fellowship for that individual. You see, that person, because of their sin, has fallen outside of fellowship with God, and now they're walking according to the world and Satan's cosmic system. We're to help them mend that relationship with God. And not only are we to help mend that relationship with God, but with other people as well. Remember, as 1 John tells us, that not only do we have fellowship with God when we have the filling of the Holy Spirit, but at the same time, we have fellowship with one another. And so therefore, 1 John 1:9 is given to us so that we have cleansing and forgiveness of our sins, so that we have a mended relationship. We are back in fellowship with God. We are joined with Him and walking experientially with Him once again. And the same goes for our fellow mankind. We can mend relationships with one another. And so in this verse, what we have here is help to restore them back to fellowship, help them to understand the rebound technique, to rebound, recover, and now go forward, not looking what lies behind, but reaching forward to what lies ahead. Help them understand that. Help them understand the grace of God in the payment of their sins, the forgiveness of their sins, and then also help them to restore that fellowship with God by teaching them the Word of God. Give them the encouraging word that they need within their life. Help them then to mend relationship with their fellow mankind. Help them to, you know, make amends for the wrongs that they might have done. Apologize to people for the sins that they might have committed against them. If there has to be some form of repayment, you help them with that repayment if necessary. Help them to work towards that repayment, whatever the case may be. Help them to build the bridges in their lives back to God and then also back to other people. Restore such a one. And in the same respect, again, if you're going to help them restore fellowship with God and with man, what's the first relationship that needs to be restored in that example? The relationship you have with them. In other words, you need to restore a relationship with them first and foremost. Help them by having a relationship with them. Help them by showing them the grace of God. Help them by showing the love of God and not hold their sins against them. In other words, you need to forgive them of their sins just as God has forgiven you of your sins. And so that relationship of restoration starts with you first, and then once you have that relationship going, now you can lead them in fellowship with God and with fellow mankind as well. Then as we talk about in verse 2, again, bear one another's burdens. And again, carry the load for one another. Bear one another's burdens and thus fulfill the law of Christ. Ultimately here, the law of Christ is what? Agape love, impersonal, unconditional love, laying down your life for your friends, loving one another as Christ has loved you. that self-sacrificial love that we talk about, and bear their burdens. Help them to overcome whatever their alcohol or drug addiction might be, whatever their sinful ways might be, whatever sin they are getting involved in on a consistent basis. Or as we even see in the book of Galatians, going back to the law and thinking that that's the way of living the spiritual life. Help them to overcome the pull of legalism within their life, the pull of the law within their life. Help them to overcome those things and restore them back to fellowship. Bear one another's burdens. In other words, help them carry the load, because it's hard to overcome these things within our lives. It's hard to stop sinning when we've been doing it on a consistent basis. Help them to overcome them. And again, go back to Thursday night's lesson. I think it was Thursday night, might have been Tuesday night, but we talked about AA a little bit, and you all know about Alcoholics Anonymous. And the thing I just want to mention briefly there is, remember, in AA, everyone has a sponsor. And the sponsor is there to help them, to support them. When they want to pick up the bottle again, when they want to take the drug again, the sponsor is there to help them to step away from the cliff that they're about to jump off of. And the sponsor is there to lead them and to guide them back into what? Fellowship. Back into righting their own ship. Getting away from the temptation that is coming at them. Helping them to deal with the anxieties and the problems and the difficulties that may be in their life. Help them in that sense. So again, bear one another's burdens, ultimately be a sponsor for them and help them go forward. Then now it says in verse 3, for if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. Here we see the avoidance of self-righteous arrogance is necessary. In other words, we can't think that we're all, you know, great and holy and sinless in our lives, because we won't be able to help our fellow mankind. When we recognize in humility that we're a sinner and they're a sinner and their sin is this way, but our sins is something else in our lives, it may not be as egregious or it may not be as visible as their sin, but we all have sin, and sin is sin. Again, there's not, you know, as the Catholics would say, venial and mortal sins. There's not mortal sins being, oh, you're going to die because of that sin, and then venial sins, oh, that's just a little white lie. Not so bad, okay? No, sin is sin. And if we commit sin all the time in whatever category, it still is sin. And it has removed us from our experiential sanctification. It's removed us from fellowship with God, and it can also remove us from fellowship with other people. So again, we can't have arrogance within our soul if we think we're going to have love for one another. In order to forgive somebody of their sins, you have to recognize that you've been forgiven much for your sins as well. Then what we see in verse 4, and this is a great aspect for us to understand, it says, but let each one examine his own work, and then he will have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone. And it says, and not in regard to another. You see, what we have in verses 2, 3, and then in verse 4 is the individual, again, on the negative side, the person that isn't operating in agape love, this is the person that wants to play king of the hill. I'm better than everyone else. I'm better than you. And they look at and they compare themselves, they look at their works, and they say, well, I'm better than that person. I don't have the sins that they have within their lives. I'm a much more holy person than they are. Aren't I wonderful? And they look for approbation. They look for people to pat them on the back, praise, and they even look for God to do that as well. And many times they run other people down so that they look better in their life. But as God says, you know, just rejoice in your own goodness. Rejoice in your own divine good production. Rejoice in the mentality of your own soul. And look at the things that you've done in your life, and then be happy and satisfied with those things. And rejoice. And as it says, in regard to ourselves alone. Don't get into comparisons. You know, we don't have to play king of the hill. We don't have to compare ourselves this one to that one. We don't have to be better than the next person. All we need to do is walk in our relationship with God and be happy at that. So again, it's okay to rejoice in our divine good production, and we should, but we shouldn't do it in such a way that we try to make ourselves out to look good or better than our fellow mankind or our fellow believers. Again, rejoice in the divine good production that you have. Take peace, happiness. Get excited, get exhilarated, and share that with God. And thank God for what you've been able to do and what He has done through you. And again, rejoice in that and have a great positive mental attitude as you go forward inside of His plan. And then the last one is verse 5, where it says, bear your own load. We're going to flesh this one out a little bit more this morning and then get into verses 6 through 10. But ultimately, bear your own load. Now, here we're talking about carrying your own load. And we all have responsibility to carry our own load. Even the reversionistic believer that we're here to help restore and here to help regain fellowship with God. Everybody has to bear their own load. What does that mean? In other words, we're all responsible for our own decisions. You see, I can't make decisions for you. You can't make decisions for me. It's not, and remember what we've been talking about, especially in chapter 4. We've been made what? Adult sons. We've been adopted into the family of God as adult sons. We're no longer little children, right? Well, as little children, guess what? Your parents made decisions for you all the time, right? Somebody else always told you what to do, when to do, and how to do it. But as an adult, no, you make your own decisions. And that's what we are. We're adult sons. And therefore, we have to make decisions for ourselves. We have responsibility and accountability for our own lives and our own spiritual walk. And so when it says, for each one, you know, each one shall bear his own load, we have to take accountability and responsibility for ourselves, even if we enter into reversionism. In other words, we've got to make the decision to rebound and recover. We've got to make the decision to go back into the plan of God for our lives. We've got to make the decision to say no to the temptations that come that lead us into sin. We have to make the decisions. We've got to bear our own load. But at the same, it's interesting here. It says, restore another, carry their load, carry their burdens, but then we got to bear our own load at the same time. So again, we see the duality of what we need to do in the spiritual life. And it's also given to us so that people don't become, and what's the word I'm looking for? They don't become addicted, as we'll say it that way, to other people taking care of them. And again, that's what we have in the, I won't get off on a political speech right now, but that's what we have in the United States of America. We have a political system that is making people being addicted, and the better way to say that is enslaved to poverty, called the welfare system. And they don't have to work. They can, you know, the government will take care of themselves. In other words, they're not bearing their own burden. They're letting somebody else pay for their way. I don't know, I think I shared this with some of you. I think Bud sent the email around. I'll give you the credit for that. I think you sent it around. But there was an interesting email that he sent out this past week that talked about, it had a map of the United States of America. And then it highlighted 11 of those states of the United States of America, 11 of the 50, okay, states in the United States of America currently have more people on government assistance than they do people who are working within that state. So more people are on government assistance within that state than are working. In other words, they're not carrying their own load. You know, they're letting someone else bear their burden, and they're addicted to it. They're enslaved to it. And we have generation after generation where now they just, this is the way of life. And again, you can't maintain that kind of system, as you know. The other aspect about that email that was interesting is that, you know, the average person, in the United States who is on government-assisted programs earn, on an average, about $30,000 a year, where the average worker in the United States of America earns an average of $20,000 a year. So again, you have a $10,000 difference, and it's $10,000 more in your pocket to be on government assistance than it is to go out and earn a job. Talk about a backward system and an upside-down system. And talk about not bearing your own load, okay? They're waiting for everybody else to take care of them. Again, we talk about that in our political realm. Is it no wonder that we end up with people doing that in the spiritual realm as well? Again, we need to bear our own load. We need to carry our own load. And we need to make decisions for ourselves and not be looking for everybody else to help us out of a jam. But yet, the grace of God also tells us as believers, if somebody is in a jam, give them grace and go and help them. So you got to balance the two, okay? And there's a balance that we need to have in the mentality of our soul. Again, in the grace of God, we ought to bear one another's burdens, but yet everyone has a responsibility, first and foremost, to bear their own load. So when we talk about that, bearing our own load, there are two spiritual applications that come out of this that are really based on that one topic that I just talked about, making good decisions for ourselves each and every day. We're responsible and accountable for that. But as a result of bearing our own load, there are two things in regard to the spiritual realm that we note. The first one is that for the believer who is a habitual sinner, again, we call it the backslidden individual, the reversionistic individual, those who are grieving and quenching the Holy Spirit, walking outside the will and plan for their lives, guess what? In time, God will judge them because God judges all of our lives. And if we are walking in righteousness, the judgment of God says, okay, I can bless that individual. But if we're walking in sin, human good and evil, then the righteousness and justice of God based on his love have to come into our lives. And then, therefore, we have those three stages of divine discipline that we know about. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, and also chapter 11, verses 28 through 22, especially, again, we know that God disciplines his children. Again, and anybody who has children knows that to love them, you must discipline them. Again, you can't abuse them, as we've seen in our news most recently. But there is good and righteous discipline for individuals. And God does that with us as well. And if ultimately are we walking outside his will and plan, he will bring discipline into our lives so that we get back into his plan, so that hopefully we wake up, because we're not learning on our own. And so God will bring in divine discipline. Some are weak, some are sick, and a number have fallen asleep. He will bring in discipline to try to get us to wake up to our spiritual deadness and get us back into the plan of God. And when I say spiritual deadness, I mean experientially, not positionally, because you can never lose your salvation, as you know. So again, for the believer, there is divine discipline. We got to bear our own load. And if we walk outside the will and plan of God, we're going to bear the burden of what? Divine discipline. I'm not going to go through the doctrine right now, which I could if we were doing a more exhaustive study on the book of Galatians. But as you know, the main aspect of divine discipline is mostly self-induced misery. Again, because of the poor decisions or the bad decisions you've made, you're going to suffer. And you have self-induced misery. And God doesn't even need to lift a finger. You're doing it to yourself. And if we don't learn from that, then the stages of divine discipline can come into our lives to intensify the suffering that we are going through in order to try to wake up, try to get us to wake up and get back into the will of God. Now, then we also, in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, 4, it says, "For I am conscious of nothing against myself." So here Paul is examining himself and saying, you know what? As far as I know, there's nothing that I'm doing wrong. I'm not stepping outside the will of God for my life. He says, "Yet I am not by this acquitted, but the one who examines me is the Lord." In other words, basically what he's saying, you know, the Lord knows better than I do. And the Lord continues to judge us all day in and day out and works in our lives, either blessing or discipline as necessary. Because he is the one that examines us. He is the one that knows our heart. He is the one that truly knows what's going on in the mentality of our soul. And so therefore, combined with 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses, again, 28 through 32, we also see the divine discipline of the Lord can come into our lives if we are stepping outside his will and plan. And we got to bear that because we got to bear our own load. And so I guess that's another aspect of, before I get into the second point, another aspect of that is, you know, sometimes we think people are getting away with stuff. And we think they're getting away with sin. But they are not. And they never get away with sin. Again, especially when they're hurting other people and they're habitually walking in sin. They never get away with it, okay? Again, God eventually will bring judgment into their lives for the sin that they are walking in. And so what we also have to remember within all of that is that we aren't the ones to judge them. We aren't the ones to condemn them for their sins. Again, there's one thing to point out wickedness and unrighteousness in this world. But it's another thing to judge and then condemn someone as a result of how they're functioning and operating. It's not our place. It's God's place. And so therefore, free up your mind. And, you know, if people are walking in sin, again, don't just say, oh, go ahead and walk in sin, but recognize that God has got them in his hands too. And he is working in their lives. And they aren't getting away with anything, but God is there to help them to overcome the sin and get back into a place of blessing. So when we recognize that, it frees us up to just say, well, I'm just going to give grace here, and I'm going to give agape love. I don't have to worry about disciplining that person. It's not my job in the first place. The Lord will, if necessary. I'm here to what? Help restore. And that's what I need to do. All right, and then the second aspect of all of this in regard to the spiritual realm is that one day we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ, all believers. Now, for unbelievers, you know the great white throne is for them. That's Revelation chapter 20. But for believers in 1 Corinthians 3, 10 through 15, 2 Corinthians 5, 10, and then also 1 John chapter 2, 10, it tells us, you know, we're going to stand before Christ. That's called the Bema seat of Jesus Christ. And there he judges not our sins, because that was paid for at the cross, but he judges our works, whether we did good or bad, as he calls it, as the Word of God calls it. And therefore, if we've walked in the righteousness of God, we're going to stand tall. We're going to stand firm before God when we stand before him, and Jesus will judge us. And for all the divine good production, the fruit of the Spirit that we had here on planet Earth, we'll be rewarded in the eternal state. And as you know, as I've taught, star differs from star. In other words, you're going to have more things adorning your resurrection body that will make you reflect the light of Jesus Christ even greater in the eternal state. And as we also see in the book of Revelation chapter 2 and 3, we see that there are privileges also, rulership, authority, things like that, that, again, we just have a glimpse of, we'll know more about in the eternal state. So again, if we are walking in righteousness, we're going to bear our own load. In other words, we're going to be blessed in time and then also in eternity. But at the same time, if we are operating in reversionism, we'll stand before the judgment seat of Jesus Christ, we'll be saved, we'll get to heaven, we'll have a resurrection body, but we're going to lose out on rewards and blessings for the eternal state because we haven't produced fruit here in time. And so again, we got to bear our own load. At the judgment seat, you know, nobody else is going to be there to say, you know, oh, let me take that from them, or let me give this to them, or let me give that to them, or it's my fault, not theirs. No, we're all going to stand before the Lord and bear our own load. So again, both in time and eternity, the Lord has us all in his hands. He has us all in his loving hands. Discipline is a loving thing, as many people don't want to admit that or believe it, but it is a very loving thing because the alternative is what? Sin, evil, human good. And that's much worse. And so again, in 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. And hopefully there's more good than there is bad. And then in 1 John, we also see, it says, now little children, abide in him so that when he appears, we may have confidence and not shrink away from him in shame at his coming. So again, if we are walking in righteousness, we're going to stand firm. We're going to have confidence. We're going to say, bring it on, Lord. You know, I did your will and plan. And I can't wait for these rewards and blessings. But for the one who has been in reversionism, they're going to what? Shrink away. They're going to be embarrassed. They're going to finally, you know, get the recognition. They're finally going to have recognition within their own soul that they didn't do what God wanted them to do on planet Earth. They're going to have the uh-oh scenario, okay? So again, we don't want to be the ones that shrink away, but we want to be the ones that stand firm. And we're excited for the appearance of our Lord, talking about his second coming here, and again, the Bema seat that will follow soon thereafter. Again, the rapture of the church, and then the Bema seat of Jesus Christ for believers. So the fact is that we are all accountable to God for ourselves. That's bearing our own load. We're all accountable to God. We're really not accountable to one another in this sense, but we are accountable to God. We are accountable to one another in the fact of loving and fellowship and grace and restoration and those types of things. But we're accountable for our own mental attitude. We're accountable for our own spiritual walk. We're accountable for our own selves before God. We've got to bear that load up. And what's interesting is in verse 2, when it talks about, you know, bear one another's burdens, You have one Greek word, and then it says, for each one shall bear his own load. You get the word load there. You get a different Greek word. And the second one is used more, again, in verse 5 when it talks about load. It's talking about, you know, the load that you would put in a cargo ship, okay? And the first one talks about just a heavy weight, okay? So when we're talking about dealing with other people's problems, that's not such a heavy weight for us to carry. But when it deals with our own situations and our own life, that's a much more heavy load that we have to carry. Because it's all about, you know, us and what's going on in our lives. But remember what the Lord said, and as I talked this past week about burdens, remember, you know, God is there to also help us carry our own burdens. You know, bearing your own load, you know, may sound like, oh, boy, that's a tough thing to do in the spiritual life. But really, it's not. Because the Lord says, cast all your cares on Him. Cast all your burdens on Him. And bearing your own load means giving it to the Lord as well. And again, how do we give it to the Lord? By walking in fellowship, by trusting in His Word, by applying His Word on a consistent basis. Not allowing the temptations of fear, worry, anxiety, problems and difficulties and disasters overtake us, but instead giving that over to the Lord and saying, Lord, this is yours. And so the fact of the reality is when you give it to the Lord, He's bearing your burden, but guess what? You're carrying your own load. Very interesting, isn't it? But He's doing all the work. And you get the blessings as a result. So in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, it says, so then, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. And again, this doesn't mean work towards salvation. You are already saved, so now live experientially. Again, with fear and trembling, with respect for the Lord and recognizing, you know, that you have accountability for your soul and how you walk in that each and every day. For it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for His good pleasure. You see, we've been created as vessels for God. Let's be vessels of honor to the Lord rather than being vessels of dishonor. Again, vessels of honor walk filled with the Spirit. Vessels of honor walk in love. Vessels of honor forgive their brother for their sins. Vessels of honor restore one another. And vessels of honor carry their own load by casting their burdens onto the Lord each and every day. So now we get into the second part as we understand the second application now of agape love. And as I have for the heading, the use of our money. Again, especially in regard to our pastor teacher. And so let's look at verses 6 through 10. It says, and let the one who has taught the word share all good things with him who teaches. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, this he will also reap. For the one who sows to his own flesh shall from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows to the Spirit shall from the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we shall reap if we do not grow weary. So then, while we have opportunity, let us do good to all men, and especially to those who are of the household of the faith. So ultimately here we're talking about our ability to give and serve one another. This is also part of agape love. This is the application of agape love. And in verse 6 here, when we go back and it says, and let the one who is taught the word share all good things with him who teaches. Now, in the Greek, it starts off right with the word share here. And again, the word share is koinoneo, okay? Koinoneo. And ultimately, it means to share, to partake in, participate, contribute, to give, to share. It's in the present tense, the active voice, and the imperative mood. And so what do we have here in the imperative mood is a command. You see, Paul uses this technique in many of his writings and many of the books that we have that Paul wrote. At the end, he starts to give in all these little imperative moods, okay? And he kind of wraps everything up. He's like, do this, do that, do this, do that. And again, these are mandates that we have in the spiritual realm. And even though he's, you know, kind of giving us a lot of, like, you know, what we call, you know, he's peppering us with all these last-minute commandments, again, these are all very important things. And so again, this is a mandate that we have to share, as the Greek word tells us, koinoneo. And ultimately, there's another Greek word, koinonia, that many of you may be familiar with, but koinonia is a cognate of this. But when it is used in the New Testament, it is used for that word fellowship. And that's what you see all over 1 John chapter 1. So fellowship is kind of an understanding, but it's a different word. Koinonia means fellowship. That means relationship. And again, that two-way communication that you have with the Lord and with one another. Here we have koinoneo, and ultimately this means to share, to partake. In other words, it means to be a participant with. And so that's what we have here. It's in the present tense and the active voice, which ultimately tells us this is something that we are to habitually do, consistently, continually doing this sharing, continually sharing, and in the active voice, we're the ones that need to do it. And so it's very interesting that this word, it carries with it the basic idea of commonness, something held jointly by two or more parties, meaning also a partnership. You see, unfortunately, when we receive material blessings here in this world, what do we typically have the most, typically people have the mentality of, this is mine, and it's mine, I'm going to keep it to me. Rather than saying, God has given this to me, this is God's. And what am I doing with what God has given to me? You know, am I going to go bury it in a hole somewhere? And when God returns, say, God, look, you know, everything you gave me, here it is back to you. I don't know if you recognize, I'm talking about the parable of the talents, okay? But the one that had 10 talents, he went out and utilized his talents, and ultimately he utilized the material blessings God gave to him. And when God came, he had 20 to give back. In other words, he had even more. He took the blessings that God gave to him, and he had more blessings, and ultimately we could say glory, that he was able to give back to God. And the one that had 5 did the same thing, and 2, etc. They all utilized what God gave them, because it was what God gave them, and they utilized it towards God's will and plan and purpose in this world and in this life and in the generation that they're living in. And as a result, they had even greater blessings as a result. But the one that kept it to themselves and just buried it in a hole. And again, this is mine. That one came, when the Lord came back, they just had the, whatever God gave them, that's what they still had. And God said, you wicked servant. You know? And he took whatever blessing that was for them and he gave it to the others. So again, many times we think what God has given to us is mine. And we get that mentality, and this world is all about that. You know? And unfortunately, to live in a conducive society like we do, you know, we buy a piece of property, and we have a house, or maybe we're renting an apartment. We think, this is mine, okay? This is my space, okay? No, it's God's. God gave it to you. It's all God's. And we draw these boundary lines, or, don't walk on my grass because this is my grass, okay? And I want my grass green. I don't want you walking on my grass. No, it's God's grass, and it's for everybody to walk upon. It's for everyone to share. And so that's the mentality that we have here, and that's the mandate that we have. Again, these material blessings that God has given to us, it's not mine. It's God's that we are to use to serve him. And so the object that we have here, let's turn in our Bibles. Let's go to the book of Romans chapter 15. Let's go to Romans 15. And in verse 27, so when we also see this word koinoneo, ultimately when we talk about it and it's used in the New Testament, it has the concept of sharing. And then inside the Christian community, again, that it talks about sharing with one another. Okay, inside the Christian community, inside the family of God, as we would say, and as we have here, especially with those who are teaching the Word of God. In Romans chapter 15, verse 27, it says, yes, they were pleased to do so, and they are indebted to them. For if the Gentiles have shared in their spiritual things, they are indebted to minister to them also in material things. Now, the backdrop is this, is that, you know, again, the gospel was first given to what? The Israel and the Jews. And they were down in Jerusalem, and that church down in Jerusalem. They started the early Christian church, but they were under tremendous persecution, and they were very poor. And so as Paul is talking to the Romans here, again, he's talking about people that contributed to the church down in Jerusalem, who had much need. But yet the ones in Rome were very prosperous. They had abundance. And they were able to now share with those in Jerusalem. And as he said, you know, those who shared with us spiritual things, in other words, the gospel came up from Jerusalem to the people in Rome so that now they're saved. And they say, well, hey, if they shared that with us, then even much more, we should take the material blessings that God has given to us and share it with them. And again, that's this commonness. That's the koinoneo that we talk about. Now, let's also look at Romans chapter 12. Let's go to Romans chapter 12. And in verses 10 through 13. Now, does anybody have a King James Bible this morning? I don't think you do. Okay. And in the King James Bible, instead of the word share, it probably had the word communicate. Bud? Okay. Back in Galatians. Sorry, back in Galatians 6. I know. Just you and only you. You go back to Galatians 6. chapter 6, verse 6.
Yeah.
Okay. So instead of the word share, okay, as we have translated well in the New American Standard Bible and most other translations, the King James, using the Old English, has the word communicate. And it's like, okay, you know, and that's how they translated koinoneo. And ultimately, the Old English for communicate isn't just about talking to one another. That's one usage of that you communicate, is I'm communicating to you now. But in the Old English, it also had the definition of participating and sharing, okay? And unfortunately, because of that translation, many people have mistranslated what this passage is all about. But ultimately, it's talking about that sharing, that partnership. It's not just about communicating the Word of God here. It's about the partnership. But we could also say, when you do share with your pastor teacher, what are you doing? You're continuing to allow the communication of Bible doctrine. So in a sense, we get it, but ultimately, in the King James, that was an old English translation, but not good for what we have today. So again, you can cross that word out and see the word share as you have it. All right, let's go back to Romans 12, and let's look at verses 10 and 13. Now, in Romans 12, verse 13 specifically, you're going to have the word contributing here. And this is the first time in the New Testament that the Greek word koinoneo is used. And so anytime the word is used for the first time, that's what we call the first mentioned principle, we have to look at that word and say, okay, how's it used? And then that has the general concept of how it is applied through the rest of the New Testament. Okay? So we see that in Romans chapter 12, now in verses 10 through 13. Well, let's go back to verse 11 just to get some context. In verse 9 to get some context. In verse 9 it says, let love be without hypocrisy. So we're talking about love here. Don't be a hypocrite with your love. Abhor what is evil and cling to what is good. All right, so don't be a hypocrite with your love. And so now we're talking about love, agape love, as we were in Galatians 6. It says, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Well, we just read one of the aspects of that is restoring people to fellowship who are in reversionism and bear their burdens. It also says, give preference to one another in honor. Again, that's the humility, the gentleness of your soul and grace orientation. Not lagging behind in diligence. In other words, do your job. Do what you're supposed to do. Fervent in the Spirit. Again, be excited, filled with the Holy Spirit, and go forward to serve God. And then it also says serving the Lord. Then in verse 12, rejoicing in hope. Persevering in tribulation. Devoted to prayer. You know, this is all part of agape love. Then it goes on to say, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. So that word contributing there, again, talks about taking of our material blessings and sharing that with others. Although in the overall doctrine of giving, we can talk about our talent and our time as well. But here we're talking about materialistic blessings. All right, let's go back now to Galatians 6:6. So we have the basic idea of this commonness. We have the idea of sharing. And then in Galatians 6:6, it says, let the one who is taught the word. And again, we have Greek words there, keteo, ultimately for the word for teaching, which ultimately means taught. That's used twice here. So we're talking about the student of the word of God, the one who is taught the word of God. We're talking about the student, the congregation, we would say. And they're taught hologos, again, the word, which is Bible doctrine, and the word of God. And then they are to share it with who? Again, with the one who teaches him. Same Greek word as the one for taught is the one for teaches, but we have, you know, different definition for the Greek word. We have different voice, moods, and tenses, okay? And so, ultimately, the one who is taught the word of God is to share, be in partnership with, have commonness with the pastor teacher. And then we have the adjective phrase or clause at the end, which is all good things. And again, all good things. Again, the material blessings that God has given to us. And that phrase, good things, many times it's used throughout the New Testament. Sometimes it's used for the gospel message being communicated and shared. But other times it's just talking about material blessings being or are in view. So here we understand that it's the material blessings that God has given to us. Share all good things with the one who teaches. In other words, whatever God has blessed us with, again, it's not ours. We don't own it. And so we have to stop having that mentality of, this is mine. In other words, we have to share that in God's will and plan. Now, the one who teaches also, not are we just talking about pastor teachers, but who else is a teacher of the word of God? The evangelist who goes out. And again, who's teaching what? The gospel message. And so again, we are exhorted, we are commanded here to support our pastor teacher, to support the evangelist who is going out and spreading the gospel message. And we are do that with the material blessings that God has given to us. But unfortunately, too many people in this world, it's all about themselves and what God has given to them, and they think they're going to hoard those things. They hold on to those things, and they don't have the attitude of sharing and the attitude of giving. So we're going to come back on later on this week, and we'll talk more about that in the doctrine of giving as we understand it. But ultimately, let's just go to 1 Corinthians now in chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. Again, just go back a book, past 2 Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And so in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, specifically in verse 3 through, we're going to go down through, we're going to go all the way down to verse 14 here. But in verse 9 it says, am I not free? Am I not an apostle? Have I not seen our Lord? Are you not my work in the Lord? If to others I am not an apostle, at least I am to you, for you are the seal of my apostleship in the Lord. So ultimately, Paul's saying, you know, this is the position that God has given to me. All right. Then he goes on to say, my defense to those who examine me is this. In other words, people were saying, oh, he's not an apostle. And we're going to see in just a minute, they were saying, you don't need to contribute to him. You don't need to help support him. And being an apostle was a unique spiritual gift, as you know, which was a combination of many spiritual gifts, including pastor and evangelist. And they all were wrapped up in that gift. And Paul operated more like an evangelist at first when he would go on his missionary journeys, and then he would be a pastor teacher for a time being. But remember, Paul never set up shop in any one location. He kept going and moving and kept witnessing the gospel until his imprisonment and death. But yet he would leave behind pastor teachers in every location where there was positive volition and he would establish a church. Okay? So in verse 4 it says, do we not have a right to eat and to drink? Or do we not have a right to take along a believing wife? And again, this is what funny how the Catholics are saying, oh, you shouldn't be married, okay? Paul, the apostle of Jesus Christ, is saying, don't I have a right to have a wife? Yes, I do. Everybody else does. Why can't I have one? Again, the legalists were saying you shouldn't have a wife. Even as the rest of the apostles and the brothers of the Lord and Cephas. Again, even Peter had a wife. It says, or do only Barnabas and I not have a right to refrain from working? It says, who at any time serves as a soldier at his own expense? Who plants a vineyard and does not eat the fruit of it? Or who tends a flock and does not use the milk of the flock? In other words, the soldier who is enlisted, again, he's not earning his own wage and then going out and fighting the battle. The one that enlisted him, they're paying his way. The one who plants a vineyard, again, he's not going out. The farmer's not going out and earning a job somewhere else, but he's taking the fruit of the vineyard. That's how he supports himself. And again, the tending of the flock, again, you can reap from your flock and provide and support yourself and your family from that. In verse 8, he says, I am not speaking these things according to human judgment, am I? Or does the law not also say these things? For it is written in the law of Moses, you shall not muzzle the ox while he is threshing. God is not concerned about oxen, is he? Or is he speaking altogether for our sakes? Yes, for our sake it was written, because the plowman ought to plow in hope, and the thresher to thresh in hope of sharing the crop. If we sow spiritual things in you, is it too much if we should reap material things from you? If others share the right over you, do we not more? And again, because of the evangelist and the missionary type of message that he had, again, he's helping them to understand the giving and the sharing that they need to have of the material blessings that they should be giving to them and in the support of the ministry, support of the church. Now in verse 14, it says, so also the Lord directed those who proclaim the gospel to get their living from the gospel. So in other words, as your pastor teacher, I'm not supposed to go out and get another job. Okay, I'm not supposed to go out and work and do something else and think that that's how I'm going to support my family. I need to trust in the Lord and then also to trust in you, that you're going to have the right mental attitude, that you're going to have agape love and be partners and sharers in this ministry together and not think I've got to go off and support my family on my own. So again, we all need to have that mentality of the commonness, the sharing, and again, helping one another as we go forward to support our local assembly. Because again, if the congregation doesn't support the local assembly is not going to exist because the pastor won't be there. There won't be the one that is able to teach. There won't be the one that is able to feed you the spiritual things each and every day. And as he sows spiritual things, is it, you know, should he not expect also to reap material things from those he's sown the seed into? So again, that's the principle and concept that Paul is giving us here and the mandate that we all have to share and support our local assembly and especially our pastor teacher and then also other ministries like evangelists that go out into the world and share the gospel message to the lost and to the dying. So that's our mandate. Again, support our local pastor teacher and the evangelist as well as best as we can, the missionary as we would call it. Again, and have the understanding. This isn't mine. Remember, God gave it to you. And God wants you to use that to support His word, His will, and His plan. And if you're holding on to it because it's yours, ultimately, His will and plan is not going to be furthered through you. And there's going to be lack. There's going to be things missing. There's going to be things that just don't get done because of your stinginess and because of your negative mental attitude of not having agape love towards your pastor teacher and treating him as if everything that you have are his as well. All right, so 1 Corinthians 9, as we read, 1 Timothy 5, 7, and also Luke chapter 10, verse 7. All right, so we'll close there. Let's just close our in bow and prayer as we also prepare for our communion supper this morning. So, Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you for helping us to understand these object lessons of agape love so that we can continue to walk in your will and plan faithfully unto you, serving you and glorifying you, being obedient to the word that you have for us. And so, Father, we ask that you help us to love more and better each and every day as we grow spiritually, all by the power of your Spirit. So, Father, we thank you for this time. We ask that you be with us as in the remaining portions of our service this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you very much. And now we prepare to take a communion. And I'd like to have you turn your Bibles. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 2. And if I could have the deacons come forward or the ushers to come forward. Pass out the communion elements. All right, so now is a time where we're going to take of the bread and the wine, celebrating our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So let's just pray for this portion. Father, we ask that you help us to concentrate and focus on the words that you have for us this morning, that this time be meaningful and real to us as we celebrate you and your Son Jesus Christ for all the blessings that you have given to us. In Christ's name we pray, amen. If we could pass out the communion elements.
He traded his crown for a crown of thorns. He picked up his cross and laid down his sword. He stumbled down the road, bruised and beaten for me. Jesus walked the way of grief.
Thank you very much for passing out the communion elements. And passage I chose for this morning's lesson also goes along with that word koinoneo, because there's a sharing that our Lord did on our behalf so that all of us could have eternal life and salvation. And we share in that with him. And so ultimately, what I wanted to read is Hebrews chapter 2, and specifically in verses 9 through 18. So let's just read there. It says, "But we do see him, who has been made for a little while lower than the angels, namely Jesus, because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone." And that's what we're here to celebrate, that Jesus Christ did taste death. He suffered that spiritual death on the cross. He suffered this physical death on the cross, was buried, and then raised 3 days later. He experienced that for us. So again, paying the penalty for our sins, as we know. In verse 10, it says, "For it was fitting for him, for whom all things and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory," that's you and I, "to perfect the author of their salvation through sufferings. For both he who sanctifies," again God, "and those who are sanctified," you and I, "are all from one Father. For which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren, saying, 'I will proclaim your name to my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I will sing your praise.' And again, I will put my trust in him." And again, it says, "Behold, I and the children whom God has given me." So again, we're seeing this partnership. We're seeing this union, this commonness come together. Again, that we are all one. In verse 14, it says, "Since the children share," again, that's our koinoneo, again, "share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same, that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might deliver those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. For assuredly he does not give help to angels, but he gives help to the descendants of Abraham." And again, That's talking about supporting Christ upon the cross as well, and then also the faith that we have in being children of Abraham. Verse 17, therefore, he had to be made like his brethren in all things, that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For since he himself was tempted in that which he has suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. So here we see our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ having taken on the sins of the entire world, being sacrificed for each and every one of us so that we could ultimately be saved. Him going through all those temptations, him taking on our sins so that he could understand what we have to struggle with each and every day. And as it says at the end, so that he can continue to be our mediator here now in time. And Christ is there helping us and mediating for us. He is the go-between between us and God the Father. He's there to help us and sent his Spirit to help us and instructs his Spirit how to help us each and every day. Because he understands who we are. He shared in our flesh and blood. He became weak like us. And he knows our weaknesses. He knows our infirmities. He knows everything there is to know about us. Not just in the mentality of his soul, because he's God and he knows all things, but also experientially, because he became like us. And as a result of that, he then went to the cross without having any sin within his own soul, and ultimately paid the price so that we would not have to. And so sharing in that flesh and blood is why we eat this cracker. It reminds us of the humanity of Jesus Christ. It reminds us of him being all-powerful God, becoming, as I'd like to say, a little cockroach, you know, for you and I, okay? He became, you know, something much less than what he was. And he suffered in that body, just as you and I suffer in our bodies in the physical realm each and every day. And he also suffered the temptations of not his own sin nature, but of Satan and the cosmic system. And yet he endured through all of that by the Word and by the Spirit so that he could be a perfect sacrifice for you and I. So ultimately, we eat this bread in recognition and in thanksgiving for Christ becoming like us, suffering as we suffer, understanding us completely and fully, and then therefore paying the price for our sins. So let us celebrate and give thanks to God by eating the bread. And as you know, this cup is all about that spiritual sacrifice, the shedding of his blood. Again, the life of the animal is in its blood. It does not have a spirit like we do. So, again, it is represented in the shedding of Christ's blood. He did not bleed to death on the cross, but ultimately he suffered spiritual death first and then gave up his life. He breathed his last, he exhaled, and he refused to inhale. Ultimately, the blood is represented in the sacrifices of the animals, that they gave their lives as Christ gave his for us. He died spiritually so that we would not have to. Represented in his physical death and then ultimately being raised on the third day, representing the resurrection that we now live in right here on planet Earth and the resurrection body we will get one day. And so in celebration of what Christ has done for us, the payment of the penalty of our sins, giving all that would believe eternal life, we celebrate and we give thanks to him in the Eucharist, unto him and to God the Father, and we drink the cup. And so now with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, Father, we thank you for your great plan of our salvation. We thank you for your Son being obedient to that plan and fulfilling it to the fullest and ultimately paying the price so that we would not have to. And Father, we thank you for our own personal faith. We thank you for our salvation. We thank you for giving us eternal life and entering us into your family. And we ask that you lead us to glorify you more and more each and every day as we grow in the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Father, we thank him, and we thank you, and we thank your Son, and we thank your Spirit also for empowering and enabling Christ on the cross and for empowering and enabling us in our own spiritual lives. And we ask that you be with us going forward this day in Christ's name. Amen. All right, if you could pass your cups down to the aisle, they will be collected. And now is a time also, as you know, that we partake of our offering. And again, this is that grace offering. And as I've had on the board for several months now, and but reminding you of the verse we talked about this morning. Again, the one who is taught the word is to share all good things with the one who teaches him. Do not be mocked. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. The one who sows to the flesh will reap from the flesh. If you sow to the Spirit, you'll reap to the Spirit. But it says, whatever a man sows, this he will also reap. So now is our time to support our local assembly so that we can continue to go forward as a church, glorifying God in all that we do. So thank you for your offerings, and now's the time. Let's just pray right now. Father, we thank you for this offering that we're about to partake of, and we offer to you the first fruits of all the material blessings that you have given to us, and we give them to you knowing that they're yours, in yours in totality, Father, and we ask that you use them to support and serve within our local assembly. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. Pass the offering. The last thing I need is to be heard.